Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2023. We have apologies from Alec Growley, who will be replaced by Jackie Bailey. And we have apologies from Stuart McMillan, who will be replaced with Ash Reagan. This morning we're going to begin our inquiry into the recovery of NHS dental services. In our first panel, we will be considering public perceptions and experiences of the recovery of NHS dental services. And I'd like to welcome to the meeting Margaret McKeith, who is the Assistant Director at the Alliance, Professor David Conway, who is the Professor of Dental Public Health at the University of Glasgow and Honorary Consultant in Dental Public Health at Public Health Scotland, and Dr Manal Ashelli, who is Project Coordinator at the West of Scotland Regional Equality Council. Thank you very much for giving us your time this morning and your written submissions. So we estimate that this session will run until 10:15, so that gives each member approximately 8 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. So I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, and I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. I invite witnesses to briefly introduce themselves, and I'll start with yourself, David Conway.
David Conway, Professor of Dental Public Health at the University of Glasgow Dental School and Honorary Consultant in Dental Public Health with Public Health Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Margaret McKeith. I'm an Assistant Director with the Health and Social Care Alliance.
Good morning.
Good morning. My name is Manal Ashelli. I'm a Project Coordinator for several projects with West of Scotland Regional Equality Council.
Okay, thank you. Can I just say, you don't need to touch your buttons. Okay. Broadcasting will do that for you. Thank you very much. I'll now turn to questions, and I would pass to Murdo Fraser to ask the first question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for coming along. I'd like to look at the question of the impact the pandemic has had on access to dental services. And I'll start with yourself, Margaret McKeith, because I know the Alliance have done quite a lot of work in this area. And just to contextualise it a little, you know, I think we all recognise there's always been a section of the population who are reluctant to go to the dentist anyway. But I wonder to what extent we've seen more access problems since the pandemic. Certainly, I think all MSPs will have been contacted by constituents raising concerns about the time it's taken to get appointments. This seems to apply particularly to NHS patients, whereas, you know, private patients perhaps have found it easier to get access, but NHS patients are really struggling, and indeed in some parts of Scotland, NHS dentistry has either disappeared entirely or seems to be disappearing. So there does seem to be an issue with access. So maybe I just start by asking, you know, what do you think the experience of the pandemic restrictions has been on attitudes towards accessing the dentist, and what needs to be done about this?
Okay. I think before I answer the question, I'll just put it in context. I think it's relevant to know how we came about doing this piece of work. This was part of a 12-month primary care lived experience programme that the Alliance were funded by Scottish Government to undertake. And part of that was really looking at the experiences that people were having accessing primary care services. And our first piece of work was accessing general practice services. And then round about that time, you know, speaking to the people leading a dentistry within the Scottish Government, they were having increasing number they were hearing anecdotally around people having concerns accessing dentistry. So that's why we were asked to do this short, sharp piece of work. So we had it was time limited, so there were limitations around it, but we were specifically looking at what people's experience has been accessing dentistry, dental services, and we asked them to make reference to the most recent appointment. And so that would span the COVID period. So out of the people who responded, 50% had been making reference to their experience within the previous 6 months. So that had been October 21 to March 22. In total, 75%, the period between April 21 and March 22. So that was us when restrictions were in place and restrictions were being lifted. So this was short, sharp piece of work. So that's it's really just key themes we were able to identify rather than specific detail. But what we found is that people did have challenges accessing dental services. We don't know, we didn't ask whether they were, we can't compare how they were to pre-COVID. We just know what people's experiences were at the time. And people had significant challenges accessing dental services, particularly NHS services, because we heard from across our survey and our interviews that a lot of practices were not accepting new NHS patients. We had reports from about two people who said they had been registered as an NHS patient but had been deregistered during this time. Obviously, I'm basing this on what people told us.
Yeah.
We heard that people who were able to pay privately or join as a private patient were not disadvantaged, put it that way. So there was a significant problem, but our research didn't extend to pre-COVID, so I can't compare that. There also seemed to be a huge lack of understanding around what services were available on the NHS. And there we picked up some inconsistencies, whether they were actual or perceived, I'm not sure, but certainly seemed to be a lot of confusion around, is my dentist open, can I go, why can I get this treatment, why can I not get that treatment? And there was a level of confusion as well as actually difficulty getting registered.
Yeah, so I mean, that's one of the questions I was going to follow up and ask you was the level of public information provided to people about what dental services were available during the pandemic, and your response would suggest that people just didn't know what was available.
Yeah, so some did, some did, but some clearly didn't. And again, that raised an issue, which I'm sure Manal will go on to, is the accessibility of information for people, particularly those who have maybe got sensory loss or sensory impairment, or those whose English was not their first language. So there appeared to be, what we heard was a lack of information and on top of that, a lack of accessible information.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Dr. Manal, do you want to come in?
For the minority ethnic people, they were struggling to access the dental services, by especially those who just came to UK prior or during the pandemic. Especially refugee and asylum, they were not able to get registered at all. They have been put in a waiting list, and unfortunately, even young children being put in waiting lists. And those who has been registered and moved from their location. So I have one story of a Syrian family has been located to Isle of Bute. They were struggling at Isle of Bute. They decided to move from Isle of Bute to Motherwell because they have people from their community there, so to receive support. When the mother was with her child, the mother doesn't speak English at all, and the child is only 12 years old. There is no sort of support in bilingual support in Motherwell, so they get in touch with us to help them to register with the dentist. We tried with all the dentistry at Motherwell, and we were not successful. However, because it was emergency case, we had to call the emergency line, which is on that has been published on NHS website, which is 111. We contacted them and asked if it's possible to register the case with them as an emergency case, and they said, well, this person is registered with the dentist, we cannot take them. Yes, they are registered, but they are at Isle of Bute, not at Motherwell. So technically, it's very difficult for the mother to go back. There is no sort of support. You don't have the permission to speak on behalf of them. You don't have the consent. Well, I have the consent. How can I send it to you? So it was a very difficult situation to make this arrangement. Unfortunately, we put the child, 12 years old, as an interpreter, to do the interpretation for the mother. However, they have been in the country less than one year, and it was a real struggle. These stories we deal with every single day in our organisation. We have to, with all services, dental services or NHS services, although there is a huge of information on the website, if we navigate it, for us who speak English is not a problem. We can navigate, although it sometimes take time to navigate this information. But those who doesn't have the language or doesn't speak, or their English language level is very low, it's a bit struggle for them. They cannot reach the information. Another case I would like to present is about those we managed to book them. They had to wait on a waiting list. And those who were lucky, they had we needed to respond to COVID response questionnaire, because if you would like to visit any dentist, you need to respond to that questionnaire. However, the lengthiest questionnaire was not possible for the patient to respond to. Has a lot of medical information, which is they were not able to answer those questions. So we had to interfere as well as an organization to fill that gap, and then play the as a third party and fill that information on behalf. Again, because all of us were working in the remotely from home, it was a bit difficult. So we had to do arrangement for them to reach. So I have a lot of similar cases because of the challenges and the barriers they face, such as the IT skills. Some of them, they don't have IT skills as well, so to deal with this. Some elderly people, they didn't know how to use phone to respond to those information. And I'm quite happy to answer more questions if you want me to.
Sure, I'm sure some colleagues will want to come on to that as the session goes on, but perhaps I could go to Professor Conway and just get any observations you have on this question of public attitudes in terms of access to dentistry as a consequence of the pandemic.
Probably not any information on the actual attitudes or behaviours per se of the public. The data largely shared in the report are the routine administrative data that we hold in Scotland to manage the dental service. So these are based mainly from the claims that dentists put into National Services Scotland and is used to pay dentists. And we have a secondary purpose to look at look at contacts and treatment activities within dentists. So I could share with you a kind of flavour of that over the pre and post pandemic, if you like.
If you can briefly, that'd be helpful.
So very briefly, I mean, the headline figure was pre pandemic. We were in a relatively reasonably good place, with about 95% of the population registered. That did mask an element whereby about three quarters of people were attending regularly. But in the scheme of things, that was a high level of activity, up to about 5.5 million treatment claims per annum pre-pandemic. Mm-hmm. Now that dropped to 1.5 million in 2020-21 and has reached only 3.8 million treatment claims by dentists, so that's courses of treatment, if you like. So that's a drop of about 1.5 million.
In percentage terms?
In the percentage terms, that is about two-thirds to 70% current 70% activity.
Yeah. So a drop off of about 30%.
A drop of about 30%. But when you look at actual treatments, there's more treatments within each of these claims. So some of the treatments go higher to about 80%, such as fillings, for example. Okay. So about 80% of pre-pandemic levels.
Yeah. Great. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jackie.
Could you maybe tell us how the Child Smile programme was impacted, both at a community level and a clinical level? And Professor Conway, I think this is a question for you.
To declare that we in the University of Glasgow are heavily involved in monitoring and evaluating that programme, which has been highly successful. Inception from 2005-06 and 15 years of developing and evolving and improving child oral health in Scotland dramatically over that period. We've seen real reductions. Child Smile is several things, just for clarity. There's a lot of activity in nursery schools and early primary school. There's a lot of activity with health visitors and support workers who act like link workers in the community. And there's a lot of work delivering it in general dental practices as well. So across all of these areas, we're heavily impacted by Child Smile, particularly in nursery and schools, which when we in our evaluation, the supervised toothbrushing programme, which had reached about 90%+ of nursery schools participating in that programme, and that had been a significant contributor to the improvement in oral health in children, that all stopped when lockdown came in, so the end of that school year, and then for the entirety of the next school year. There was lots of reasons for that in terms of access to nurseries and schools and the restrictions around that. There was a lot of redeployment of that Child Smile staff. 75% plus were redeployed into a number of frontline COVID activities like vaccination. So there was a lot of explanations for why that stopped at that period. And it in the last school year and currently, it's probably we're back to about 70% of that activity in nursery settings. General dental services in the primary care setting is impacted the same way I was describing in terms of children's access to dentistry. And I suppose that's worthy of a comment post-pandemic. While registrations, because people stay registered once they're registered, that as I said, they were high. The new registers for the 0 to 2s are not coming through post-pandemic. So that was always difficult to get children registered. So it was about half of 0 to 2s were registered pre-pandemic. That was a big goal of Child Smile to improve that. That's dropped to about 25% post-pandemic.
I mean, whilst I would always make the observation that registrations aren't activity, I absolutely agree with your concerns that if people aren't registered in the first place, it's very difficult to then make an impact. Can I take you to maybe pre-pandemic? Because I don't know whether it was you or one of the others in your evidence to the committee suggested that, and I quote, prior to the pandemic, persistent inequalities in child oral health were recognised as an ongoing challenge for the programme. Can I ask why that was, given the community infrastructure you've described, which is really effective, and was Child Smile in need of reform, but the pandemic exposed its weaknesses?
We recognised pre-pandemic and even still that the inequalities in by area-based deprivation, yep, that measure, SIMD, S-I-M-D, that there was a difference in oral health of dental decay levels in children. And that was an ongoing aim of Child Smile to improve and address that. We had made some inroads in that we had improved the population, or we'd improved the decay levels across all SIMD areas, but we just hadn't levelled that gradient. So we were tuning into what elements of the programme would better target that gradient and improve, particularly in those in the more deprived areas. So Child Smile is a range of universal things, like in nursery education, but also some targeted initiatives, like the support workers linked to health visitors in deprived communities. So it's, we call it a universal and targeted programme, a proportionate universal type programme. So it was trying to do that.
Okay. Has it got back to the level it was prior to the pandemic?
No, I think we're about 70% in terms of that activity in nurseries. And when we look at the oral health outcome, the worrying statistic on oral health is that the improvement that we've seen for 15 years has stalled. So it's not, the way we collected that was different, but it's not, the improvement's not continued in the same trajectory that we had been observing pre-pandemic.
Okay. I wonder whether you could just, because I don't, you talked about the community workers, the health visitors, as well as high street dental practices. How do you monitor what they deliver in the Child Smile programme?
There's a really a detailed monitoring programme. So the high street dentists are monitored in the same way through the claims system, through NSS. There is a bespoke database developed by the University of Dundee Health Informatics Centre that monitors a lot of the activity in nurseries, schools and support workers, and ourselves and the University of Glasgow analyse that data, and we look at the impacts of delivering and receipt of the interventions and the outcomes in oral health, and that's where we've been able to see that the linkage between elements of the Child Smile programme and improvements in oral health. I mean, it was a real flagship programme, and it has been following the work in Scotland, been adopted across the world, actually, and we've been part of sharing that message.
No, I'm very proud of the Child Smile programme. It was something that the last Labour government put in place and has been subsequently continued by the SNP government. So, you know, it's something that I think has transcended political parties as an excellent programme. Because if we're not operating at the same level as we were before, what does a recovery programme specifically for Child Smile look like?
Well, yeah, we have got a management group, and we've brought a lot of that health improvement into Public Health Scotland. Now, remember, Public Health Scotland wasn't there prior to the pandemic, so that Public Health Scotland's role in all of that has been ironed out and developed. But we are conscious of trying to certainly monitor that, trying to improve that the uptake of the different elements of the programme, and particularly the one we want to get back to is the nursery supervised toothbrushing programme. And there's still challenges, I think, in that sector in terms of fully getting brushing back into it. There's some hesitancy, some nervousness about some elements of toothbrushing. I mean, there was a lot of issues around concerns about COVID spread, for example. So we had to redevelop the guidance to ensure that these concerns were taken care of.
Okay. One final thing before I don't know if any of the other members of the panel want to comment, but one final thing to yourself, Professor Conway, because you mentioned slow recovery of training and support for the programmes. Why is this, and how urgent is it that programmes for adult oral health are reinvigorated?
Well, yeah, as I said, same goes for that. They're probably, ironically, more in their infancy, the programmes for adults than children. They're newer programmes, 5 years or so. They're more focused on training different staff, like care workers in care homes, to improve oral health. They're not as multifaceted. We're, as I said, reviewing them collectively. What can they learn from Child Smile? It's kind of different processes. The fact that Child Smile also includes the general dental services and the high street dentists is a real important element to that.
Okay. Don't know if anybody's got anything to add.
Yeah, I can come in if that's okay. So some of our survey respondents sort of made comment to the fact that they were going to the dentist when there was a dental emergency. And there was one of the questions we asked, what would good dental services look like? And what came across quite clearly was that more of a focus on prevention. So that would be perhaps an adult version of the Child Smile programme, but very much a focus on prevention and public awareness raising of the need to go to the dentist. It's around the why people should go to dentists, why people should maintain sort of good dental and oral health, and also around what not to do, around smoking, tobacco, etc., etc. So there was an identified gap in sort of public health information, as well as information on what services were available, how to access dental services, and also a lack of information around the charging structure, for instance. So I think an awareness raising campaign would be very helpful.
Thank you. Anything to add?
Well, we had a very good experience during the pandemic. We worked closely with the Child Smile team. Because part of the project was raising awareness about the health services to minority ethnic. And we worked well with them because we invited them along, although it was online through Zoom, but they have provided a lot of educational services, and plus they have advised us when we struggle where we can register those families. They provided also a list of all the dentist around Glasgow, which was very helpful. The other question was from us to them, can we find any minority ethnic dentist in those lists? They said it's quite difficult to to find something from the data, but the only we can advise you is to try to phone them all, and you probably end up finding those who has a minority ethnic background, and following their advice, we managed to reach a few people. So I think they are doing well, although there is some gap between the minority ethnic and the Child Smile team, but we are trying to help them to reach these unreachable communities. Thank you.
That sounds very positive. Thank you, Convener.
Professor Conway, can I ask you a quick question? You said that you're currently running about 70% of what you were previously in terms of the Child Smile uptake, and there was a bit of hesitancy in the nursery education, the nursery programme of getting supervised brushing. Is that from staff or is it from families?
No, I think we're probably, to be honest, at the stage of trying to identify where these barriers and facilitators lie, whether they're at staff level, whether head teacher of the unit, or whether it's even educational directorate kind of level. But we're trying to explore some of the ways that we can try and improve and build that into the kind of daily activity. So using some of the examples where it is working, can we like spread that word in those that aren't back up? I mean, there always were some nurseries in early years establishments that weren't engaged in the programme, and that was a gap pre-pandemic we wanted to address as well. So okay. It's an ongoing challenge to try and optimise that.
Are you confident that you can get the levels back up to where they were pre-pandemic?
I'd like to be optimistic that we could. I mean, that is the key improvement. I mean, we're wanting to actually do a bit of communications with this group to say, actually, this has made such a big difference. It's made a big difference to the health of the children in nurseries. Mm. We're actually doing a bit of work to see the impacts on school attendance of the relationship between dental decay, the high need for general anaesthetics, for extractions, and time off school.
Right.
So actually there's wider social benefits to improving the health of these children, and actually they've been part of that effort as well.
Okay, thank you. Brian.
Thank you, Kavira. Good morning, panel. I'd like to just follow on from some of the question that Jackie Bailey said around inequalities. And there always was an inequality, and I think you say in your submission, Professor Conway, that was increasing pre-pandemic anyway, but the pandemic has exacerbated that considerably, and the figures would back that up. I think the gap was, it says here, it's grew from 7% to 12% from 2010 to 2020, but from 2020 to 22 and up to 20%. I mean, that's an obvious direct correlation with the impact of COVID. And I think looking at the pressures that have been put on dentistry and reading through some of the evidence, the idea that the longer period of time between seeing a dentist means that when you do see a dentist, the treatment required is gone up significantly. Therefore, the time per patient has gone up significantly. So there's almost like a perfect storm here. And even when you speak to private dentistry, they're incredibly busy as well, and it's actually quite difficult to get an appointment with a private dentist. So we're obviously in a situation where the system is under extreme pressure. And given that this is COVID Recovery Committee, what's the pathway back from that, do you think? Where do we start?
Yeah, I think it is a big challenge. I think we've kind of been here a little bit before in early 2000s, there was a workforce crisis in dentistry back then. There was a challenge to get access to dentistry. When a dentist opened a practice, there's the image, you can find it from Stonehaven, queues around the block. So we've been there, and then there was a lot of concerted effort across oral health improvement and services and workforce planning and modelling and recruitment and increase in numbers of dentists in the system. So the workforce, I think the workforce is part of this challenge, by the way. I think the drop, it doesn't look like a lot in the scheme of things, but it's a big drop that we've had directly due to COVID. The dental schools had a year where they didn't output a whole cohort of students. So every year dental school was deferred and so we didn't have the output. So we've dropped a new joiners to the workforce. And so there is that the numbers of dentists that are active in the workforce is down pre-COVID. So that's, I think that's a big part of that. So that's probably an important part to start in the solution. In terms of inequalities, yeah, we had them before, and we were always keen to address them to meet that unmet need. But yeah, it's exacerbated because there's a smaller number of appointments, and the gap between those more affluent, more deprived, is stretched a little bit because the least deprived are less likely to access or less able to get in.
I'm always, you know, as most of my colleagues know, I'm very, very interested in the prevention angle of healthcare in general, but in dentistry, it would seem that's something we need to, as a long-term solution, but you've got a short-term crisis. So how you know, again, looking at how we work our way out of this short-term and long-term, and any of the panel, obviously, I'm happy for any of the panel to speak this, long-term, short-term, how do we map our way out of this sort of crisis in dentistry?
I can maybe pick up on the comment about health inequalities, and I think, you know, COVID exacerbated what was already a significant issue for many, and certainly across not just our worker in the dental services, but the wider alliance work, we're seeing, you know, that the impact that health inequalities are having on many, many people. But one thing that we did realise is that half of the respondents were not aware of the NHS low income scheme, for instance. So perhaps having more people sort of accessing support to pay for dental services would perhaps be part of a solution. So it's that awareness raising of what is available and what is there to support people accessing services. But what came across, not surprisingly, but I wasn't particularly happy reading, is that, you know, people saying that, you know, dental care is now a luxury for us. You know, somebody made comment about a scale and polish on the NHS is £38. That would put some people off because that could be a weekly food bill for a family. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we were hearing things like that coming through. And 38% of respondents, so that's almost 50%, said that no, dental treatment should be free of charge, the same as other healthcare is free of charge. So that came across. And again, saying that no, dental treatment was a right, not a luxury. And for many, they're seeing it as a luxury right now. So it seemed not happy reading.
Just interested, just to dig in a wee bit deeper there, because the reality is, for many people, dentistry is free of charge.
Yeah.
So what you're saying to me is that there's those who don't recognise or don't realise that dentistry is free of charge. Yeah. So there's a marketing issue here.
Absolutely. What we noticed, like during the going back to the perhaps some of the work we did around accessing GP services, there was a large public sort of messaging campaign around your GP practice is still open, it may look different, etc. And I think that was reasonably successful. So something around maybe a longer-term campaign around accessing dental services, you know, support with treatment, know about options available, and support for paying that, and what would make you eligible for free dental care. Because I think that lack of understanding or lack of knowledge is potentially putting some people off.
And I imagine, Dr. Shelley, in the communities that you're working with, that messaging would be even more difficult.
Yes. Although the Shunbright, when we done that project, it was 3 years of changing behaviour. So we try to raise awareness about the services that's available, as well as changing their behaviour, because we are dealing with people have a different culture. So we try to understand their cultures and how these cultures impact on their oral health. So, and then we had to design our delivery to make them to understand how their daily practices impact their oral health. So it's a quite, it was what we have found that there is lack of understanding, understanding the system. So they don't understand the system. They don't know exactly if they are, for example, if they give a birth, the baby has have the right to register from. From zero. So when we did, because when we engage them, we give them a questionnaire to see the level of their knowledge. So the vast majority of the group of people that we worked with, and they are diverse people from different background, their knowledge was between 20 to 50. So if they reach 50, is most of the people they thought dentistry is will cost him if they go, and even when they register, they say, we don't know that if we go every 6 months, it's a free of a charge. They don't know about that. So there is a lack of information, lack of awareness, as well as a difficulty to navigate what is available in the system. The vast majority we deal with, they struggle financially. So they are living in the private areas, plus they are struggling financially, so they were not aware. Even myself, I became aware about the using the Child Smile team when they do the flushing for the fluoride. We don't have the information that they can reach four times per year by doing twice at the school and then at the dentist, because so many of them, they go there, they do the routine check, the dentist don't offer that. So all this information was provided while we were delivering that project. So it's a bit difficult for them, yes, because of the language barrier. Difficult for them because misunderstanding of the system, and because of the digital excluded, because they are most of them, they are they don't use computer, or they don't have even the capacity to buy computer or access or have the skills to do this. So we had a complex case, to be honest.
Yeah. Do I have time for a small one? Or
possibly we'll come back to it, Brian.
Okay. Thank you.
John.
Thanks, convener. Maybe I should start with a confession in that I go to the dentist when they send me a reminder. My dentist has stopped sending reminders. Therefore, I have not been to the dentist since before COVID. So I'd be interested to know if that is a common experience, if we think. But I think my main point to start with is, you've talked, especially yourself, Professor Conway, about claims being at 70%, fillings being at 80% compared to pre-COVID. I mean, is there an actual measure of how people's actual dental health is? I mean, does somebody get 100 people in a room and look at their mouths and see if it's deteriorated over the last 3 years? Or, because with children, I think there is a measure of decay, as I understand it.
Programme in primary schools. Yeah, the National Dental Inspection Programme, Primary 1, Primary 7, got good data. Adults, not so good. Limited to some questions in the Scottish Health Survey, which is self-report. And so the measure that we pulled out of that is really whether people have no teeth or not. So the dentalists are really the end game of poor oral health. So there's very little adult oral health information. I think there's an opportunity to collect that in primary care routinely. We've thus far not taken that opportunity to capture diagnostic information like you would in any other health context. So you could get simple oral health information from that contact. At the moment, we're just left with, like you were saying, just the treatment selectivity rather than the health. So I think that's a gap.
Yes, and so that takes me on to kind of, well, what can we do about that? And also, well, first, actually before that, then, so we can assume that for quite a lot of the population, including myself, our dental health is deteriorating and perhaps will continue to deteriorate for the next few years until that 70% goes up again?
I don't know if we would definitely know that, but yeah, certainly over time it would generally deteriorate without any intervention, and prevention, as was asked before. Actually, it's a, like a really cornerstone of what dentistry is and should be about as well.
So I suppose my next question then for all of you is, where should we go from here? I mean, the government has said in its response that they plan to continue the blended system of payment with listing all the different things, fee per item, capitation, allowance and direct reimbursement payment. Should we be moving to more like a GP system where they're paid a much larger amount for...
I think the actual costs and the payment of dentists is probably a bit beyond my kind of expertise input, to be honest. But certainly on the prevention side, which is where I'm more interested, I totally agree with the previous question that prevention is a route to where we should be prioritising. Child Smile is an excellent example of trying to do that really right. We did some modelling. So it doesn't come for free, but even the brushing programme costs approximately £2 million per annum. But we realised within 5 years, £5 million of savings and reduced treatment costs. So it's a case study in preventive spend. So you invest, but you can realise these savings. And I think dentistry per se is an untapped potential for prevention. There's a lot of common risks between what we do in dentistry, what the risk factors for dental disease, like gum disease, the main risk factor is smoking. So actually, a real important role for dentists to deliver smoking cessation, do that properly, get that reimbursed. So in terms of reimbursement, I would be investing in some of that prevention rather than just always on the treatment side.
Okay, I mean, I take your point that the financial side's not your primary area of expertise, but it obviously has an impact. And I mean, some of the information we've been given, it sounds like the NHS dentistry is dying and the private dentistry is growing. I mean, if we ended up with private dentistry full stop, would there be any prevention then?
I mean, that's the big gap in the data, this private data, the level of private activity. We don't know whether that is filling that gap or whether it's not completely filling it. I mean, I think maybe you've got some... survey information.
Yeah, again, but again, just our survey was very, very, very small, so I wouldn't. We only had like 91 respondents to the survey itself, and out of the 79 were registered for NHS dental services. Four were had a private dental plan. One who responded was unable to register due to availability of NHS services, and two had left their practice as two were unregistered as their practice was no longer seeing NHS patients. So out of the people who responded to us, 79% were registered, but that's no way of knowing what reflection that is on the national stats.
Can I just check if this survey has been published as yet?
No, it hasn't. It hasn't been published yet. We're hoping, we're still sort of in discussions with the primary care team within Scottish Government, who this was a piece of work sort of commissioned by them as part of grant funding. And we there was sort of toing and froing with the survey itself, and we're just sort of still waiting for that formal sign-off, but we're very keen to publish it.
Yes, I think that'd be helpful.
Very keen to publish it. Yeah. And so, that's why I wasn't able to share it ahead of this committee.
Okay, I understand that. So, I mean, looking forward, have you got views on that as well? Do you think, I mean, we just tidy up the present system, or do we need something more major than that?
I think my own personal view, based on my own experiences and based on what we've heard during this short piece of work, is I think probably a radical overhaul is perhaps required. I think there were some people who did respond. Generally, people who respond to our surveys have got a strong feeling either way. They're either very happy or very unhappy. And what came through in some of the free text was a concern by two or three, I think it was three people, that said that they're seeing, desecration was the word one of the respondents used, of NHS services, and the creation of a two-tier system and having fears of a move to a completely private system. And so we didn't specifically ask that, but that people volunteered that information themselves. But
do you have views at all on the financial arrangements, or is that not your scope?
Yeah, I think that's not our area of expertise. We were more interested in asking people what their understanding of the charging structure was, not what the charging structure is, because I'm not fully understanding of the charging structure.
If I could come to you, Dr. Shelley, do you think, I mean, you've talked a bit about more information, we need to get more information about the present system. So is that what we need to do, or should we actually be changing the system?
I think it's changing the system, to be honest, because I will present a case. Okay, this happened during the pandemic again. The case was she registered with the dentist. She knew her dentist. She contacted the dentist for emergency because her filling was falling, and then the dentist said, "You are an NHS patient. We are sorry, we cannot take you, but I'm suffering. I need emergency treatment." And I said, "Well, we cannot book you under the NHS because NHS, exact the word what they said, because I was in the middle of the conversation, it's on hold at the moment. What we can do is to book you with a private," and they offered her a private appointment the following day. That was a bit disappointed for me. Second case was is a bit similar, but there was the cost was a bit high. They said we the treatment is not covered with the NHS. We can give you an appointment. We can give you a price for the private, and we can take you immediately. And that was again, it's a bit disappointed. How come as a dentist you refuse to take me under NHS, and then you? What is the policy?
So do you think, how should we change the system? Should it become more like a GP, that there's virtually no private GP work and it's all in the NHS?
To be honest, is I have a comment about even GPs because
okay.
I have...
Okay, we'll not go there, we'll not go there.
Yes, I'm sorry. I don't want to go for that. But I think is as a patient, I need to know my right. And I need a policy that protect my right. And I need the dentist know that's my, I know that's my right. I know that I have the right to go for the treatment under the NHS. Okay. And you need to offer me that. I don't know how we put that in practice. It's okay. A bit difficult.
Right. Okay, thanks so much. If I can just have a final question. One of the new things that seems to have come up is vaping. And I just wondered, Professor Conway, is there any evidence that vaping is causing harm to especially young people's mouths?
No evidence that I'm aware of. In fact, we've got a trial, or we're involved with a trial that's been led by Newcastle to do smoking cessation in dental practices, dental settings, where there's three arms of this trial. Prescribed vape, starter kit, e-cigarette, NRT and brief intervention. So we'll be looking at which is most effective at reducing smoking cessation. But also as part of that, we'll be looking at the gum health associated with these different interventions. Obviously, smoking is very bad for your gums and your oral health. And we'll be looking at vaping as part of that study.
OK, thanks so much. Thanks, Convener.
OK, Brian, you had a short sup.
Yeah, I think, you know, we're trying to look forward from the decisions that were made during the pandemic, the impact on dental services. I think, you know, hindsight's 2020, of course, but trying to understand what we would do in a similar situation. Do you think the restrictions, the interventions, were correct and appropriate, or given where we are just now, the impacts and the slow recovery, were the decisions made the right decisions looking back?
At the time when the decisions were being made, dentistry was at the top risk occupation for COVID. We were right in people's oral cavities and oropharynx and aerosol generating procedures. So there was a real uncertainty of how that went and how much we could do to mitigate it. So the infection prevention control measures were very high bar. The PPE was very high. The restrictions were really hard. And I think they were right. And then when you go back in it, actually we didn't see the huge numbers of infections. Certainly we couldn't necessarily identify any from patient to dentist. That's not to say dentists didn't get COVID, but we couldn't necessarily identify that link across. So they were right and strict, and then it was how we went back. But I think there are lots of lessons for future pandemics about like sector specific, like how you would prepare for that, how you would prevent it. I mean, some of the things like the ventilation of dental clinics was something that we probably took our eye off the ball with, yeah. If we're being honest, and actually should have been like irrespective of pandemics, that actually ventilation is an issue in dental settings. So I think there's a lot of lessons to do that. I mean, there's a lot of good role. The dentists did step up in a number of different areas like surveillance and vaccinations, and there's other actions that they took part in. So is that balance of the direct COVID support activities, redeployment, versus actually keeping some of that service on the road? And I mean, again, it was a really amazing effort to get, while dental practices stopped, to have 70 urgent dental care centres established across the country for emergency care. Mm. I mean, this is at a time when no one was leaving their houses. So some of that work was impressive in the heat of that decision-making. I think the difficulty has been coming out of that. I think it's just taken us an awful long time, and then all the other things that have come with it.
Okay. Thank you, Kavina.
Yeah. just on that coming out of it, and I fully accept that I got that question, was it proportionate? At the time, for me, it was absolutely. That's the only way it could have been done, because you're spraying people's mouths and stuff's going to go everywhere. So I understand that that was absolutely essential. But it's the recovery part that I am more interested in at the moment. Did you lose dentists through COVID as a result of the stress that put on them? Because I remember going to my dentist and they were completely PPI'd in masks, going about with huge gloves. It looked absolutely... I was in there for half an hour and felt awful. And they were dressed and full of mat has. And they were like that all day. So how many people actually dropped out of the profession as a result?
I don't know the detail, but there have been people left, yeah. In terms of that 190 and the other workforce, so there's lack of new joiners to the system, but obviously some leavers as well, or early leavers. Mm. That work has continued to be monitored by NEST to look at that.
Okay. In getting people back in, you also said earlier on in your evidence that the dental school output, you weren't getting enough new dentists coming through the system. How do we sort that? Is there a way to increase the numbers of people that are actually in the courses that can be finalised and brought through, or are they just not wanting to go into dental practice in the first place?
No, there's no issue with the numbers and filling the numbers of dental school places. The main thing I was saying was we had 1 year where we didn't have an output, so they didn't graduate and they didn't go into the system and go into the NHS after that. That was because they couldn't get the experience in the training. Yeah. So that was happened to every dental student across Scotland. But there's not an issue like recruiting. But all I mean is that first time we did increase the numbers of places. We increased the numbers of dental places to meet that demand. And also there was other activities around trying to recruit dentists from overseas, from European Union, very proactive around that, and whether that's similar types of measures might be required to increase the workforce.
Okay, and where is the workforce just now in terms of what it was pre-pandemic to what it is at the moment?
As far as we can tell, it's 119. It's not exact headcount, but it's 190 less dentists claiming activity.
Right, OK. And are those posts that you're actively trying to fill, or is that people going into the private sector and just not claiming anymore? Or
there could, some of them could be, some of that number could be completely opting out of the NHS. We don't know that.
Right, OK. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, thanks very much, Professor Conway. Just on this question of training, you said there's no difficulty filling the places. Do we have enough university places for dentists at the moment?
I wouldn't give you an answer to that, but I think that could be, there could be a bit of modelling done to work that through. Bear in mind that lever is quite slow.
Yeah.
So you turn it on and you're five, six years... Mm-hmm. Maybe seven by the time you make the decisions and get that through. So it has to be other things in the interim as well.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Anybody else got any other questions? No? Right, okay. Thank you very much, folks. That brings us to the end of that session, giving us a lot to think about. So I'd like to thank you. If you would like to raise any other issues, then the clerks will keep in touch with you. If there's anything else that you want to bring up with us, give us any more information. And I'd like to thank you very much for your time, and I will now suspend this part of the meeting. We will now continue to take evidence on the inquiry. I would like to welcome our second panel to the meeting. Adele McElrath, the Interim Director of Dentistry and a Dental Practice Advisor at NHS Borders. Anthony Visoki, the Director of Dentistry at NHS Shetland. And Dr Declan Gilmore, Director of Dentistry at NHS Tayside. Thank you very much for giving us your time this morning on Zoom. Now, we estimate this session will run up until about 11:20. And each member will have approximately 8 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. If you'd like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we will bring you in. And I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak, so I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. And I'll now turn to the questions and pass you over to Ash Denham. Ash Reagan. My apologies, Ash.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I'd like to start by asking about funding. So this was funding that was allocated 2021-2022 to support the recovery of services. So £5 million was made available for ventilation improvements, and then in 2021, £7.5 million was made available for the purchase of electric, red band handpieces and motors. So can I ask, did the funding improve the availability of practices to see more patients, and did it build in that long-term resilience into the system?
Do you have somebody in particular?
I think, Anthony, I think you're indicating that you'd like to come in.
Anthony?
Good morning. Good morning, Convener. Thank you, Mr. Regan. The funding was primarily targeted at improving the ventilation to a required level in order to improve access, or to improve the amount of fallow time, which was the time that had to be left in between patients after generating aerosols. So that was something that certainly improved the access and will have a legacy long term from the point of view of having the surgeries and the practices that air changes that was required for these procedures is something that's now there and is there as a legacy. The electric motors was something that certainly was a help to begin with, and a lot of practitioners used them in order to try and improve patient access. And by improving patient access, what I mean is actually by seeing more patients per day than they were able to before these fundings were available. Having said that, electric motors, because the restrictions are now reduced or removed altogether, then the electric motors are not particularly giving any more access than they would have done prior to COVID.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else on the panel that would like to come in on those points?
Emily? Ash.
Okay. So should there have been funding provided for other measures? Because you're saying there that the electric motors perhaps wasn't maybe as helpful as it might have been. So other measures that might have improved that rate of recovery of services. And looking into the future now as well, in terms of funding for support of reform, is there other types of funding or other issues that need to be funded in order to move forward into the future?
Just put your hand up.
We go to Declan.
Declan Gilmore, yeah. Yep, Declan, could you go ahead, please?
Hello, nice to see you. Responding to your comment on the red banded handpieces weren't maybe as useful as we may have hoped. I would say it was a reaction to what our knowledge was at the time, and it was probably something that was very, very welcome and very useful at that stage. So I wouldn't want it to seem as though this was money that was not well used or well purposed. And sort of going forwards as well, these handpieces will still be utilised within practices for treating patients, not in the initial way that they had been intended, in terms of reducing the amount of time in between patients and increasing access, but the actual day-to-day dentistry, these handpieces will continue to serve the provision of NHS dentistry. So I wouldn't like to think that money has now been wasted in any shape or form. In terms of future funding, I think you'll be aware that there's a new statement of determination, remuneration for the new SDR for dentists, so a new pathway in terms of remunerating the dental professional and general dental services. And this is something that we've not got full insight into at the minute. We currently have Scottish Government and the BDA in negotiations and talks, and we're waiting to see what the outcome of those talks and negotiations are. And we'll hopefully find that those are talks that will help to retain and recruit more NHS GDS services within Scottish dentistry.
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful. Adele, I think you wanted to contribute.
Yes, absolutely. Good morning, panel. It's really in relation to your question about funding. I mean, currently, our blended payment model, which really does, it is comprised of item of services already discussed, and obviously the fees and allowances. I mean, there was a 30% uplift in one of those specific allowances, the general dental practice allowance, which really did support many practices within NHS borders, for which I can speak of. The current situation, the current climate within dentistry has really significantly changed, and that would really be in relation to dental inflation. The cost of providing primary care dentistry is very expensive at the point of delivery. So lab fees, for example, have completely and utterly astronomically, in many cases, risen to an untangible level that practices and practitioners and practice owners are really struggling to look at that. Dental materials and staffing increases in wage, which is arguably your biggest expenditure on a monthly basis if you're a practice owner. So the new payment reform is indeed incredibly welcome, is required, and will be very positively taken. The issue of dental inflation, however, is still something that perhaps would cause a concern for the future. So I'm not quite sure what additional funding could be available.
OK, thank you. And I think Anthony wants to come back in as well.
Thank you. It was simply to maybe further qualify my comments regarding the electric motors and to echo what Declan said. I think at the time that they were made available, they certainly did increase the ability for access and to increase the amount of patient treatments being able to be done. And certainly they're not going to sit gathering dust long term. They will be used ongoing within NHS dentistry. I just think my point was more to do with the specific relation of these on ongoing access in the future. But it was very welcome at the time, and it certainly was done, from my understanding, with the best of intentions in order to help dentists and help patients access help dentists access patients.
Okay, and your views on whether other measures that should have been funded to improve that rate of recovery, and you know, other funding for the future?
Well, I think at the time, other measures, I think that would be very difficult because there was so much restrictions on what we could do, amount of patients that could be seen within a dental practice or within any setting at the time. So the sector was really working at its optimum level, given all the restrictions at that point, or certainly as a general term, it was. Going forward, it's touching on what Adele said, you know, there has been a recognition that the system we're working on needs to be looked at. That's a historical issue that perhaps was highlighted during COVID and gave an opportunity to review and take stock. And I understand that's ongoing at the moment with a view to a new payments system going forward. In the relatively near future, I understand it's under negotiation at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Convener.
Thanks very much. Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd just like to explore the support that NHS boards give to dentistry services more generally, because we're in a quite a strange situation, are we not, where dentists are independent contractors. And yet, as NHS boards, you've got responsibility to ensure the general health of the population, which is delivered through this kind of network of in effect, you know, independent businesses. So just to give you an example, so I'll direct this, first of all, to Declan Gilmore. So just to put it into context, I had a constituent came to me last week for a practice in NHS Tayside. This constituent is registered with a NHS practice in Perthshire and has just been told that she won't get a six-month checkup that she's been used to, but the practice is moving to a 12-month checkup. And as we've already heard this morning, actually she's perhaps one of the more fortunate ones because some people don't get any checkups at all with their NHS dentists. But I'm interested in exploring what is the role of the health board here? You know, what do you do actually to make sure that there's good access to NHS dentistry in the areas which you have responsibility for? And I'll start with Dr. Gilmore.
Hi there. So, well, as you'll no doubt be aware that there's no legislation to, it's different to our doctor colleagues or general medical practitioners, that the health board is not required to ensure that there's dental provision in the same way. To that end, though, in terms of provision of dental services, you know, there's a wide blanket here in terms of provision of public dental services, which has their own remit in terms of delivering child smile, caring for within the Tayside area anyway, delivering dental care within our nursing homes and our care homes, and delivering special needs care within the children community, through to overseeing our independent contractors as well. In terms of ensuring safe care for our population within Tayside and across Scotland as well, of course, the health boards are responsible for ensuring that practices deliver a safe and working environment and are working to, you know, certain standards within a framework called the Combined Practice Inspection, which is a large part of our governance within practice. And that's within practices that are providing NHS dental care. Any practices that are purely private, they have to go through HIS to ensure that they're sort of ticking all the correct boxes in terms of delivering safe care. Within Tayside itself, we're aware that there's an access issue. You mentioned the patient that is going to 12-month checkups, and that's potentially, you know, sort of quite acceptable, and sort of the dentist has done an assessment on that patient's oral health and has deemed that 12-month recalls are satisfactory to ensure that patient maintains oral health, and I wouldn't have any argument with the dentist in that situation. Beyond that, Tayside, like all health boards across Scotland presently, we're aware there's an access issue in terms of NHS dentistry. To that end, we have set up a task force that involves or combines people from the dental or the health board executive, myself, primary care, Scottish Government, and our finance department to sort of see if there's ways that we can facilitate access. But for ourselves, Murdo, really, one of the big problems we have is, and it's already been alluded to in your discussions with Professor Conway, is the recruitment problem. So at present, we have empty surgeries within Tayside, and that's seen across, again, other health boards. We're not unique in that respect. And we do not have enough staff, dental staff, to fill all of the available surgeries, and that is one of the problems that we have. Again, it's also been discussed earlier on that people have maybe taken early retirement post-pandemic, or maybe had lifestyle changes, just made lifestyle choices that they want to work less hours. And these are the sort of challenges we're facing within the health board at the minute, trying to address it, discussing across the board as to, you know, sort of any innovative ways that we might be able to help, without more dentists to fill the surgeries, we will find this challenging.
Okay, thank you. Do either of the other witnesses want to add anything to that? Adele, yeah.
Oh, I'm unmuted. So yeah. I can use the mute, unmute. Yes, absolutely. I mean, health boards, we have absolutely no role or oversight into having to or been able to have even have a say as to what dental practices, who registers what patients, how many NHS patients. The only role that health boards actually have nationally is to offer emergency and unscheduled care to those who can't access GDS, and also obviously the core remit of the PDS is slightly different with slightly different targeted patients. However, within NHS borders and at, you know, feedback from regular area dental committee meetings, which are very well attended by all of GDS NHS borders, it really has been highlighted to myself very clearly that the barriers that are faced by many are very myriad in function. There's workforce issues, there's the ability to recruit on all aspects of the team. There is also the changing demographics within that. Many people have reduced their sessions or reduced their commitment to actually work. The business running costs and the actual cost of being able to deliver NHS dentistry currently within the rigid free NHS structure has been identified as a barrier. There's certainly been no practices within NHS borders that have identified that they wish to reduce their NHS commitment, that they don't want to offer NHS care, but they quite simply, and it has been reported within our ADC, have had to look at augmenting income streams to be able to continue to deliver that NHS care. To that end, when I was appointed in July 22 as the Director of Dentistry on an interim basis, I completed a survey with then we had 16 NHS GDS practices to further understand what was happening with the workforce. Because again, these are independent third party contractors. The health board has no oversight who's employed where, how many people are employed. That's, you know, that we have absolutely no oversight of that. And of that survey that I sent out, I received 12 responses, which was quite a good response rate. And of those 12 responses, every single practice at that time reported significant and protracted recruitment and retention issues on all levels of staff. They also reported that more than 67% had reduced their NHS availability to deliver NHS care. Now, that may well be because they've had to augment their income streams or indeed the work-life balance, which really has become apparent post-pandemic, or potentially both of those, and that also, more alarmingly, more than half intended to further reduce their NHS time commitment sessions, not NHS commitment, but the time available to deliver NHS dental care.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Adele. I don't know if Anthony Visoki wants to come in from NHS Shetland, but I wanted to ask a follow-up, which I'm interested to get your perspective on, Adele, and others, and that is, you talked about the role of health boards in providing emergency care. Has there been a substantial knock-on impact, therefore, on the hospital dental service, because we're seeing this problem of access? So can you talk about the experience there, please?
Yes. So in NHS borders, our public dental service has actually had to remobilise their own services and also devote some significant time and manpower to being able to support access to unscheduled and emergency care. So yes, the remobilisation of NHS Borders Public Dental Service for their core remit of patients, that's patients with special and additional needs or complex medical conditions, has been much more stagnated. We also in NHS borders have a much higher percentage of patients that could actually be registered within an NHS GDS setting as a legacy from the last access crisis, but we cannot look to rebalance that. Because we have nowhere at the moment. Access is very challenging and quite frankly precarious within NHS borders. So we would have nowhere to be able to place these patients. The increasing demands that have been placed upon the PDS to undertake domiciliary care is really increasing as well. So in terms of what the health board can do, though, and in terms of what we have done. Pre-pandemic, we had completed an oral health needs assessment. Now, that needs assessment really does set out our challenges. It gives us a focus and it sets us where we're going to, where we want to go, where we need to go. It devised 10 priorities, which we've reviewed and decided that they are still completely and utterly relevant, those priorities, obviously ranging from ranging the profile of oral health to meeting the needs of our ageing population, to maintaining and improving access, to maintaining and improving recruitment and retention, to look at the structure of our PDS, the workforce in our PDS, and very importantly, actually, an engagement between the wider dental community, the dentists and their dental teams, and the most important of all, the patient and all of the public that we serve. So we really look at that and we're really working on that. And as part of that work, which has helped us to be able to target our child smile return, it's really helped us to look at community mapping within our services. It's really helped us support a very receptive CDO office when I've approached them on two occasions to increase our SDAI application area, which was to further support access and widen access within our board area. So whilst I appreciate the actual oversight as a board that we would have over an independent GDS contractor, there's a lot of work that goes on. There's a lot of communication. There's a lot of open discussions. And in a board like NHS Borders, which may have a large geographic area, we do actually only have 19 practices now. One of those is an orthodontic practice. So a very approachable, knowledgeable basis is formed with all practices.
Yeah, maybe just see if the others want to come in. I don't know if any of the others want to say anything about the impact on the hospital dental services or emergency care. Yeah, Anthony Visoki, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. So I think I would like to draw a distinction between the hospital dental services, which are a secondary care, and the public dental services, which are directly provided by health boards. And I think that's probably what we're talking about here. But yes, in order to echo what Adele has said, that the public dental services have had to initially were the initial remobilisation of the dental services in entirety, and then they moved on to providing this, which is commonly termed the safety net for these unregistered patients, which can't access unscheduled or emergency care. And frankly, the public dental services is neither funded for or set up, structured for this type of care. It's set up for what they do, which is the special care, the priority groups. Therefore, that's had two effects, in my opinion. It's had the effect of taking the focus of the public dental service away from these priority groups, and also not being able to provide the volume of treatment that is expected in general dental practice, because it's a different demographic of patients. And I think it's been the public dental service has stepped up really well, but I think they've been asked to do work that they're not necessarily structured for. If I may, can I comment on a couple of points you made earlier?
Yes, Mr. President?
So say that, you know, that going back to in more general terms, we are working in a very unique funded model, and it's. I think the frailties of that can sometimes come to the fore, and that's where what was talked about earlier about the oversight of boards over independent practitioners, which is can be quite limited. I think the not to sort of make this too Shetland specific, but the reason I put in the evidence I submitted was to look at changing the balance within NHS Shetland in order to try and address that specific problem. Which is not necessarily the answer for many health boards, but certainly we believe it's the answer for our health board. And finally, just to touch on your constituent that mentioned about the annual exam, I think that's something that we're very wedded to this 6 monthly exam, and I think there's been a lot of evidence and certainly clinical guidance from the NICE guidance a number of years ago to say that the frequency of recall examination should be patient specific. But I think it's in our national psyche that we need to go in every 6 months. So actually being advised you need to go in annually is not necessarily a to the detriment of that patient. And I think there's a bit of work to be done both from the profession in order to give that message to individual patients, but also in general to say that, you know, some patients need to be seen less frequently. Some patient needs to be seen more frequently. And I think possibly in a smaller context, but that would come into the ability to recover. So rather than starting to recover to see every single patient every 6 months, which is a big ask, it may be that, you know, this sort of divergence from this rigid 6 month checkup that people are used to would actually help access.
Okay, thank you.
Understand, Declan, you'd like to come in?
Yeah, to be honest, I think Anthony's really covered everything I was going to say there. And maybe just to, again, re-emphasise the difference between the hospital dental services being different to emergency dental care, which is largely provided, sort of, again, a blended type system between public dental services and our GDPs come the weekend.
Okay. Jackie, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I want to pursue what the board is responsible for in terms of oversight, and it was something that Anthony touched on. So I'm keen to note, so for example, take scale and polish. First line prevention, one would think, 59% operating at pre-pandemic levels, so there's still a way to go to recover that service. In terms of the board, do you have any oversight of that? Is that happening in your area? Can you take action? Or does the problem belong to somebody else? And I'm happy to go to Shetland first.
Thank you. So specific items of treatment are decided on clinical judgment. And that clinical judgment is when a patient is seen by a dentist, the need for that patient or the needs of that patient are assessed, a treatment plan is discussed and completed. The oversight of a health board on that individual micromanagement, I suppose you would want to say, is almost nil. What a health board does is ensure that anybody who is applying to provide NHS services within that health board is appropriate, passes the appropriate applications. They are then randomly monitored from the perspective of the treatment they do. There is, Declan touched on, the 3 yearly combined practice inspections, which ensures that the treatment is carried out in a safe and appropriate environment. So the health board's oversight on this sort of thing is far more global than specific to an individual treatment, the needs of an individual patient.
Okay, let me clarify then. I'm not talking about needs of individual patients. I'm talking about preventative measures that we know have an impact on the population. So let me illustrate it in a different way. We know there's a growing inequality between children and young people registered with dentists actually participating in their local dental surgery. Prior to the pandemic, well, in fact, in 2010, it was 7%. That gap is now 20% between the least well-off areas and the most well-off areas. Now, that's a huge inequality in attendance levels. Do you get involved in monitoring that, trying to adjust that? You're shaking your head.
No, not really. I mean, it's something that, you know, we look after the registrations. We ensure that the people, that the dentists who are registered to, are listed to provide NHS care to registered patients, follow the guidance. But again, it's not something that we would have an oversight of. Obviously, there is, within the guidance and within the fee structure, there is the ability to provide preventative care and child smile, and there's been additional fees added to the fee structure over the last couple of years in order to try and encourage that. But that's the limit to the amount of oversight that we can we can see where we can give.
Okay, can I just sense check that with the other boards? I take it you're in agreement with what's been said by Shetland. Yep, I'm getting nods. Thank you. One final question from me. So the Scottish Government have committed to abolishing all dental charges. Now, given the challenges that you've outlined, dentists leaving the NHS, not enough staff, people making lifestyle changes, and given that the service is not operating at the level it was before, how possible do you think this is? And how much extra resource do you think would be required? Can I go to Tayside first?
There's a deep and difficult question to answer. Resources, I think, I'd like to think Adele and Anthony would agree that it's numbers of dentists that we're looking for. First and foremost, we need more of those. The one, and again, Adele touched on it very eloquently earlier on, and I didn't touch on it, but spoke in detail, that the new SDR needs to look in such a way that it attracts dentists and retains dentists within the system. Personally speaking, I think one of my greater concerns is that if the new statement of dental remuneration isn't attractive to our independent GDS colleagues, that we will see a further transition away from NHS dental provision towards private dentistry, and the resulting consequences there. So my greatest concern at the minute is that the new SDR is such that it keeps NHS dentistry within the provision of GDS. And if we don't do that, if we don't focus on that, then you know it doesn't matter how we tinker around the edges in terms of providing access via general dental services or hospital dental services, which exist more in Dundee, Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Glasgow. There's only so much of the fallout of that that they can cope with. And thus, thereafter, there's the problem that their core remits, the things that they have to deal with in their secondary and tertiary care, that they potentially not able to then meet their obligations in that respect. So yes, I would push very hard to ask powers that be to ensure that the new SDR is as attractive as possible to retain dentists within NHS services. Again, Adele touched on the dental inflation whenever she was speaking earlier. And I know within the report there's an example there of it wasn't actually terribly accurate. The report, there was a comment from one of the dentists talking about denture fees, and it was actually I'm pretty sure they were referring to denture repair fees, and already they're out of date because inflation's taken that further away from those numbers that were mentioned. Within our practice, we get £21.10 for a dental repair, and our lab charges us £32, including their collection and delivery fees. So we're losing money on every dental repair we do, denture repair we do for our patients. So these are the sorts of things that are sort of a barrier towards dentists continuing to work and provide services within NHS GDS.
So that strikes me as a rather long answer to say that until we resolve the problems that exist, then any question of abolition of charges is probably for the birds. I see you nodding, Adele. Would you like to add anything to that?
Yes. Yes, I'm hugely supportive of exactly what Declan has said. To abolish NHS patient charges, I would say actually is a very positive move. I mean, to remove a significant barrier for so many people to be able to access care can absolutely only be positive. The real issue with dentistry, primary care dentistry and GDS at the moment is deeper than that, and there are more, it's more myriadal in function, as I tried to explain. So dentists, being whether they're paid in 100% from the government or 80% from the patient, would not make a dentist leave or stay within the NHS. And I can speak for the NHS Borders practitioners that I speak with often. There is a reluctance to have to augment income streams to maintain the level of NHS provision. There is nobody wants to deliberately go private, to my knowledge, for that, you know, for that basis. It's patients, it's patient care. That's what dentists generally want to deliver at a very high level.
Absolutely. Thank you all very much. Thank you,
Camille. Okay. Thank you, Jackie. I'm going to move on to John now, and I'll come back to you, Brian, just because this John's theme kind of follows on.
Thanks so much, Convener. There's been a lot of doom and gloom, obviously, rightly, around the pandemic and all that's happened. I just wonder if anything good has come out of the pandemic as by way of like lessons we can learn for the future. Dr. Gilmour?
I suppose if something similar was to happen again, we are probably better placed in terms of how we respond to that. That would all depend on the potential type of virus or that was to maybe arise in the future and its form of transmission, as to whether the measures we had in place this time were still suitable for any future pandemic. But again, that's doom and gloom. Let's hope that doesn't happen. One very positive thing that we found, certainly within Tayside, was the relationships between our fellow general dental practitioners and also our public dental services as well, and our hospital dental services. We've got a much better understanding of how each different sector works, and that has arisen from probably working within the dental hubs whenever they were created, for want of a better word, at the start of the pandemic to deliver emergency care at the start of the pandemic. And so certainly something very positive from that perspective. I would say, personally speaking, again, I've just, very new to the role of DOD and also dental practice advisor, but I would say that our relationships with Scottish government and policymakers and that within that sector have improved. There's greater communication during that time as well. I don't know if my colleagues would feel the same way, but I personally think that has been a positive over the last number of months.
No, that's positive. Ms. McElrath?
Yes, I'm unmuted. Absolutely, one of the things that I was going to put RTS in to speak was actually the team environment, the communication that has greatly improved between GDS and PDS, that shared partnership, which is part of our oral health needs assessment, and I hope to develop that in the future shared care pathway, has really been paved during the pandemic. The communication with the CDO's office and the deputy CDO's as well, I completely agree with Declan, has been absolutely fantastic, and the relationships that boards have been able to make with CDO's office as well. One very good news story, however, that's came out for NHS Borders is with the CDO being so receptive to hear the issues and the precarious concerns that I had about access within NHS Borders and Good Evidence. We had very successful SDAI grant allocation scheme. We've actually had two new practices that have actually opened within the past year. As part of that scheme, we've had a third application, which has been approved for our practice, the acquisition of an existing practice, which will safeguard the NHS dental care provision that's actually offered at that practice, with a further extension of our SDAI area to now encompass the entire board area. I am aware that I have another two applications imminent. Both one is to move an existing surgery and expand, and another one is to expand a current surgery. Now, there are still issues with recruitment, concerns with recruitments, and it's worth noting that of these two new SDI practices that have opened as squads, one of them had more than 7,000 patients apply to be on the waiting list before they were even open, with no advertisement, so they can no longer register any more patients until they can actually recruit. And the other one is really struggling to recruit. They have two dentists there. They're really struggling to recruit. And with the fee structure and the rising in dental and inflation, is having to consider augmenting their income stream and still maintain the NHS commitment as per the terms and conditions of that grant, but having to look at other income streams appropriately there. So that there are good news stories. There are good news stories, but there are still the challenges that exist.
Can I just clarify a couple of points based on that answer? Do the two new practices, are they taking NHS? Are they mixed practices that will do some NHS and some private? And on the recruitment point, who sets the wages and salaries for dental staff? Is that each practice, or is there any uniformity?
No. So that's each practice. GDS, independent GDS, they are third-party businesses. So the owners will pay their staff what they decide to pay their staff. They will organise a specific percentage with their associate dentists as well, which is completely unique to them to be able to do so. And the health board has absolutely no oversight over anything to do with that at all. It's not part of the agenda for change that perhaps we would have in the public dental service there. In terms of taking on new patients, I mean, of these two new practices, one is taking on new patients, the other one can't until he actually gets some more people to come and work for him, because he is literally has 7,000 people wanting to register for him and possibly growing as well. In terms of private NHS, almost every NHS, GDS, high street dental practice is a mixed economy practice. You know, if you do one white filling, in essence, you would be a mixed economy practice. The public dental service can only offer what's available within the remit of the SDR. General dental practices can offer that and other treatments should the patient wish and should it be suitable for the patient.
OK, thanks. I might come back to you on that point afterwards.
Yeah.
But Mr. Versace, Shetland, you're a bit smaller, so I'm guessing you're all friends with each other. So did you gain anything out of the pandemic positive?
Yes, we're all very friendly up here. So I think in general terms, there was always, because of the nature of the size of the area, there was always a more of a informal relationship than there would have been in bigger boards. For that reason, you know, just that possibility. But I think going back to what's been said earlier, and certainly I did some work or do some work with Forth Valley Health Board as well, and know that one of the biggest positives out of the pandemic has been this increased collegiate working environment that we all have, both within health boards, between health boards, and also between health boards and the chief dental officer office. So there's been an awful lot more communication, an awful lot more contact with each other in order to try and work our way through these challenges that we're all faced.
OK, thanks. And my other main question is, going forward, should we be trying to change the whole system? And I think from your paper from Shetland, there is quite a desire to change it. Partly because I think you've only got one private practice, if I'm correct. So to start with Shetland then, would you just bring the whole thing into the public sector and get rid of the private sector?
In a word, yeah. Well, not get rid of the private sector, because there is a role for it. But I think, so in general terms, going back to what's been spoken about already, is that we have a very unique funding model in that we're the 80% of the provision of dental services nationally are provided by independent contractors. Now, these independent contractors have have their fees set by a third party, so that, just touching on what you said just now about, you know, what does the health board have on the, how do practices pay their staff, how all this, and they all have different overheads, they all have different, you know, the overheads in Borders are different than central Glasgow, they are different than Inverness, and are different than Shetland, but we all, those that are providing NHS services, work to the same fee structure. So as an independent business, that can be quite restrictive. So that's where the mixed economy practice really is a must in order to make sure these practices are viable. With them, with going back to the evidence I submitted regarding Shetland, the structure of the majority of dental services being provided by general dental services, i.e. the high street dentists, for want of a better phrase, in the majority of other health boards, relies on there being a significant, robust framework of high street dentists in order to provide that. So if, for instance, in Glasgow, there's in excess of, or Greater Glasgow and Clyde, in excess of 200 dental practices, so if there's a fall off in one or two, the body of the GDS can still take on the majority of the work. The problem that we've had in Shetland specifically is that over the years there's been an attempt to replicate that, but you've been sort of working from a standing start. So there's not the structure there to take on the lion's share of the work. And therefore, rather than going down that road, my proposal, and certainly I'm still in discussions and very positive discussions with Scottish Government and with the CDO, is that we are a little bit more in control of our own destiny in an island situation, and we take the services more under the umbrella of directly delivered services from the health board, rather than relying on independent practices and the challenges they face. And the other reason for doing that is that, you know, it's simply not feasible for somebody in Shetland that can't get to a GDS practice to drive to another health board to be seen, whereas they may be able to do that in a mainland health board. So there is a specific or a unique situation there that
Right, that's great. I appreciate that it is quite unique in Shetland. Dr. Gilmour, can I move on to you? I mean, should we be thinking radically of changing the dental system to more like the GPs? So the GPs almost 100% do work for the public sector and drop the private side?
It would require such a radical change of how we provide things just now. Presently, there's a restriction on what can be provided via the statement of dental remuneration in terms of dental care. And that would then have to be funded in such a way that it makes it attractive, again, for people to stay within or dentists to continue providing general dental services within the NHS. Which would require, you know, a significant monetary input from Scottish Government. At present, we've got a new statement of dental remuneration that has been, we've got sight of it just now. The main issues that we'll have going forward is, will it be properly funded and remunerated to continue making it attractive to GDPs? And I think, personally, at present, it's maybe best way forward, maybe evolution rather than revolution might be the phrase to take forwards there. A complete dismantling of the system just now, I know that some would definitely argue for that, but it would have to be funded in such a way that it keeps dentists within the NHS services. And then you'd have to make decisions as to, you know, do you include dental implants within such a service, and I think that'd be very hard to bring within a new structure as well. But
okay, thanks.
My feeling on it at the moment would be evolution rather than revolution.
Okay, we'll ask Ms. McElrath that question as well. Or?
Very quickly,
so if I can just ask you for a brief response, Ms. McElrath, would you agree with Dr. Gilmour?
I completely agree with Dr. Gilmour.
That's great. That's fine.
I completely agree.
Brian, I am going to come to you, but there's one thing I'm just looking for clarification from you, Adele, if that's possible. The grants that you were talking about, I presume, is that the £100,000 Scottish Government grants that allow you to set up a new practice?
Yes, the Scottish Dental Access Initiative that enables you to either open a new practice, buy an existing practice, or extend your current practice to widen the access to NHS dental care.
Thank you.
It also brings with it the recruitment and retention eligibility within that area for new dentists.
If I get time at the end, I might come back to you about that. Brian, I'll go to you just now.
No problem.
Thank you, Kavina. Good morning to the panel. I'd like to just dig a little bit into the inequalities. I think we heard in the last session there around the inequalities were increasing, but the pandemic has really exacerbated that quite dramatically. And I would suggest that one of the things we really need to be doing just now is looking at how we, one, reduce inequalities, but two, the whole preventative agenda, for which it was very eloquently put that dentistry is an untapped, is untapped to a great degree in terms of the prevention agenda. So with those two in mind, the sort of prevention and the inequalities, what do you think the role of health boards are in reducing that kind of inequality within dental care and oral hygiene? Can I come first to you, Ms. McElrath?
So, yes. Health boards have a great role to be able to look over that. And it's been in the very fortunate position that we are currently reviewing our oral health needs assessment. I feel that we've been able to do the absolute maximum that we can. When the NDIP programme was re-established, we did the primary ones, but we also did the primary twos because they would have been lost. They would have been missed. We set those children as a priority as well. We did the very innovative test of change. We delivered fluoride varnish at that point of contact. We have extended our child smile. We have recruited another oral health support worker. We've extended the education, extended the sites that we can deliver that, extend where we can infiltrate and where we can deliver our packs, and that they're also delivered at and signposted at food banks now as well as our early learning establishments. We've actually had a 97% response from early learning establishments with Child Smile within the borders. The government as well did also extend the child exam for GDS, so that increased the fee for the child exam. We never used to get a fee for that, and that was increased. And they also extended the age that a dentist could get paid to deliver fluoride application up to the age of 12. It used to, pre-pandemic, be 6, and you can claim your child smile and you'll claim up until the patient's 18 as well. So that's not quite answered your question, I feel. I think I've maybe digressed a little, have I? I'm sorry. I can do that. I promised myself I wouldn't do that today.
you may have a role in politics then, if that's the way you do. I think that I think what I'm trying to do is get to the solution part of it. We know that there's been real issues. We know that there's increasing inequalities. We know there's a problem with for example, the length of time between treatments has increased so much during the pandemic. We heard again in the last session that the treatment that's actually required now, there's an increase in the treatment actually required. So really, all of it's really a kind of perfect storm around the squeeze on NHS dentist time, and it's how we look at a long-term strategy of bringing that inequality back down again, or prevent inequalities rising any further before we bring it back down again. So, if I could widen it out to that, I'm happy to take any comment from any of the panel, but I'll give you another chance, Ms. McElrath, to come back onto the path.
You're absolutely correct. It's not about focusing on the one preventative programme. It's about looking at all of the preventative programmes that we've got. We've got Open Wide, we've got Caring for Smiles, we've got Mouth Matters. It's about maximising those programmes to improve education, to really raise the profile about oral health. But it's about scratching the surface almost and seeing who's underneath, who's left behind out of those programmes, and be able to have the intelligence behind that. I know that within my board, NHS Borders, we have a very strong oral health improvement team. We communicate part of that good news story of COVID was the team working, the improved team working between GDS, PDS, and all of the domains within our health board. And we really have maximised to our very best ability all of our preventative programmes, and continue to do so, and have community engagement. I have to be honest, though, that for me personally is where a lot more benefit could potentially happen on a nationwide basis. But perhaps Professor Conway may be best to call back in for that question, Brian.
If I can go to Tayside with a similar sort of a response to my question, but broaden it out slightly, because one of the things we did here in the previous session was that there was a lack of understanding of what NHS services are actually available, especially in the lower SIMD areas. So it's almost a marketing issue here. So if I could expand it into that, Dr. Gilmore, around NHS services can do, what the boards can do to alleviate that particular issue, because that seems to me something that we should be able to tackle. Dr. Gilmore.
I don't know that we're almost putting the cart before the horse here with that question, with all due respect, because while I completely agree with you that we need to maximise be very transparent in terms of what's available and make sure that the wider public from all sectors of the community are aware of what's available. We probably come back to the fact that actually, even if you are aware of what's available, that gaining access to these services continues to be problematic. So we need to sort of address both sides of the coin there. In terms of advertising, making folks aware of what is available to them, much like Adele has just mentioned there, we've got a tremendous group of people, a superb team within PDS that's delivering Child Smile, and maximising awareness within that, within their remit. And we're also working with our other healthcare providers within Tayside to deliver the information that patients require to fully understand what's available to them. Beyond that, we're sort of using our comms teams to advertise via social media platforms, communicating what's available, and as well as oral health improvement messages as well.
So I think, you know, if I broaden it out as far as we can here. So if we understand where the issues are, we understand as we just discussed there, Dr. Gilmore, that we need to make sure that everybody's aware of what services are available to them. You touched on there the fact is the service, it's not just about making them aware of what they're entitled to, but also that's available. So if I go to Mr. Versace for the key question, do we have the resource to tackle the inequalities, the increasing inequalities that we are seeing post-pandemic?
In a word, no. We don't. Touching on a lot of the comments that have already been made already, there isn't the workforce, there isn't the, I think you mentioned the perfect storm earlier on. We have an increased need because people have not been seen. We have a backlog, we have a reduced workforce, we have, independent practitioners, just as Declan mentioned about actually costing them money to provide NHS services. All that together means that a simple answer to that is at the moment, no. I don't think we do have the resource to recover services as it stands.
Okay, finally, given that we are sitting in the COVID recovery committee, we are trying to look at a map our way out of the current problem. So really looking here for the positive steps that the we can take within this building or in this environment here that could help to alleviate the issues. How do we plan our way out of this? I'm coming back to you, Mr. Versace.
Well, it's a challenge. I think maybe going back to the preventative measures, I think that's something that we need to really focus on, because they were a huge success, especially child smell. In addition to Professor Quanmi's evidence that it was specifically commented on in Shetland, that child smell team was a vital point of contact to the health boards during the pandemic and during the restrictions. And we have the second lowest decay rate in Scotland and Shetland, and we're trying to maintain that. So it's maintaining what's been done well already. But I think perhaps going back to a more general answer and talking about what can be delivered, my own opinion is that we need to maybe clarify what is involved in providing NHS dental services, and is that to maintain the health of the population, or is that to provide all dental services? And there is a difference, and I think that's something that comes into how the service is appropriately funded for providing what it needs to provide.
I don't know if whether one of our other two, whether Adele or Dr. Gilmore, yeah.
And you know, it's such a complicated answer to your question, but you know, there's no way that the three of us could, you know, even maybe possibly begin to answer that in any great detail or depth. I think it's a question that needs to be put to the directors, to the CDO, to the clinical leads and PDS, to the clinical directors of our hospital services, to if you're looking for a pathway, all these sort of different factors and facets within the provision of dentistry within Scotland need to be brought together, and each individual sort of needs and wants and problems discussed as a whole, and then sort of brought together to find a pathway, which, because obviously everything is a web of connections between the different services as well, so we all rely upon each other to provide dental services. It's going to require, I think, all of us to come together if you want to have a structured pathway towards recovery, and not one that I think that myself or Anthony or Adele can provide for you just now.
Although I will give Ms. McElrath the opportunity to jump into that question if you have anything you would like to add.
You know, honestly, I think that Anthony and Declan have both really hit that on the head. It is too complicated a simple question, Brian, to be able to give you a simple answer to, because there are so many facets to where there are so many issues. Initially, I firmly believe that prevention, education and signposting for all, and a maximisation of our oral health improvement programmes, as well as our payment reform, which we are really desperate to see if that supports the profession going forward, is a very good place to start, because our blended payment model, our item of service, we all saw during the pandemic when we were very well supported, but with our COVID emergency top-up payments, activity dropped. Now, it dropped for many reasons. IPEC, there was staff working in different bubbles, fallow, so on and so forth, but activity dropped. And the taxpayer deserves a well-balanced, economical, best service possible. And the item of service item in dentistry has always worked for that basis in terms of activity. It's about getting the other factors correct that's stretching the profession. It is workforce, it is those changing demographics, it is some governance around the nuances between different practices and who has what oversight over what it is, largely dental inflation and the running costs. It absolutely truly is within an independent GDS setting.
Okay. Thank you, Kabina.
Thank you very much, Brian. Adele, there's a couple of points I just want to bring back up with yourself. You've talked a number of times about the dental inflation. What do you mean by that? Is that just our general inflation that we're all experiencing just now, or is there some other factor that we're not picking up on?
So it's that. So it's the cost of your utility bills, which we're all experiencing right now, but it's the cost of lab fees, which are rising exponentially. Declan has touched upon that within the past 3 months. They keep hiking and hiking and hiking to the point that in many instances they are actually more expensive than what dentists are actually being paid. It's the cost of materials, dental materials, to actually purchase as well.
So is it the lab fees that are driving your inflation plus materials?
So I'm not an economist, so I have absolutely no, I can give you a great answer on that. When I refer to dental inflation, that's what I mean. I mean the increasing running costs to run a practice.
Okay. In terms of the staffing, is it just dentists that you're missing, or is it nurses, hygienists? Is it across the board?
It's across the board.
And are you competing with private services? Are health boards competing with private services for the same staff?
Absolutely. PDS are struggling to recruit in so many vacancies, not just dental vacancies for dentists. We're struggling to recruit hygiene therapists. Hygiene therapists at the moment are largely being used as almost private hygienists, and they're, you know, can get whatever they can in private practice, and you're trying to compete against that. We are struggling to get nurses, DCPs, to stay. There's also some training issues. I mean, Mentor, which is a large nurse training provider online, I think there's something about the grants are going for people over the age of 25 as well. So it's going to be even harder for practices to get more experienced people coming through to train as dental nurses. So it's the whole sector, convener.
Okay. Is there anybody else wants to add anything to that, or are you content? Anthony?
Just if I may, convener, just to add to what Adele said there, I think it is right across the board. I think we've lost a lot of staff, not including dentists, over the pandemic. And it was described very, very well earlier that what was being asked of dental staff, and a lot of people left, you know, what they had to wear, PPE, the risks. We were at the highest risk, and a lot of people, a lot of dental nurses, a lot of people working within the sector left the profession as a result of that. Frankly, the ability for independent practices to compete with the private sector on wages is very difficult, and therefore the combination of that has meant that we've lost a lot of staff, and attracting them back is going to be very difficult.
Okay. Declan, do you want to add anything, or are you content?
Yeah, quite content that Adele and Anthony have commented very succinctly there, so nothing to add.
I think we'll be looking at the model for how dentistry works next week anyway. So we will be expanding this. Listen, I'd like to thank you all very much for giving us your time this morning. If there are any other issues that you want to raise with us, the clerks will be happy to liaise with you. Oh, sorry, Declan. My apologies.
No, apologies. I should maybe just take the opportunity a moment ago to say, I know this is a discussion about reform and what have you, but I think I'd be amiss if I just didn't take the opportunity to comment about what was touched upon earlier on in terms of the, you know, the dangers and the difficulties that our colleagues faced at the height of the pandemic. Again, I think Anthony had mentioned that we're most at risk profession or perceived to be, many of our colleagues put themselves at the front line and difficult and times that their danger. Perceived danger seemed to be particularly high, and an awful lot of news coverage of how many people were dying from COVID infection and what have you. So I think it would be nice just to, at this point, mention how our colleagues stepped up at a difficult time, but continue to provide services at their own personal risk, and it would be good if that was acknowledged.
Absolutely, and I would, and everybody in this committee would absolutely concur with that. As I said earlier, I was at my own dentist. They were mat-hazed up completely. It must have been horrendous. So your point is duly noted. Okay, that concludes our public part of the meeting. We intend to continue next week's evidence session, and we will hear from the Scottish Government on the 29th of June. So I suspend this meeting to allow witnesses to leave, and we will move into private. Thank you.